And this.
Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Monica Castillo, the senior film programmer here at the JVSC, and I'm so thrilled to welcome Nancy Savoca and Rich Gay. They are two of the guests who are going to be here at our very first screening of Restored and Rediscovered, our new film festival on film preservation. And they're going to be bringing their film Household Saints to our audience, which I'm so excited to see with an audience, but I'm sure it's been an even greater joy for you all to be able to bring this movie back to audiences. But before we get into that, can I get a little bit more background of the story of how Household Saints came to be? How did you find Francine Prose's book?
Well, I was in actually I was in film school. I was doing an internship with a company that did children's movies, and my job there was among office clerical work was to be a reader. So I would cover novels that were coming out that had children's stories in them. And when I read the description of Household Saints, it was, there's a child in there. So I read the book for them, and I felt from the first line of the book, which is "It happened by the grace of God that Joseph Santangelo won his wife in a pinochle game," I fell in love with the story. I loved it so much. The company, of course, wanted to do after school specials, not this story. And I ended up writing Francine a love letter saying, I'm in film school right now, but one day I want to make a movie of your book.
And then it was, well, I don't know, it was about 7 or 8 years later that we were actually, we had made one film and we were in pre-production on another. And I asked Nancy, I said, just, looking forward, we should think about what we want to do down the road. And she said, I want that book. And so she didn't have to tell me what book. I
That
knew,
book.
I knew. And so we reached out to Francine, and she still had the letter in her files, in the days when you would have a file
So
with.
my advice for all filmmakers starting out is if you love something, a novel or something like that, let the author know right away. Let
Yeah,
them know.
write the fan letter.
Write the fan letter.
Wow, and from fan letter to actually making the movie, you also had got an incredible cast. What was that process like finding all the actors to bring that story to life?
Well, Lily, we were actually working on Dogfight when all of this was happening. So, as it started seeming that this could be our next film, I knew she had Teresa in her. It had nothing to do with the character she was playing in Dogfight, but I just felt, and it turns out when I told her, I said, "Would you be interested in playing a girl who wants to be a saint?" And it's Saint Lazare. And she said, "I just did a play about Saint Lazare, and I did all this research. And I would love to play Teresa." So that kind of fell into place. She brought on Vince D'Onofrio, who of
Yeah.
course played her boyfriend in Mystic Pizza. So that was a little bit of an adjustment for us, but of course not for Vince or Lily because they're actors. And so it was, you never doubt for a second
Yeah.
the father-daughter relationship they have. And then Tracy only came in because we were fans.
Yeah, and of course, casting director put pretty much the rest together, except in that first meeting with Francine. She said Judith Molina has to play the grandma.
Carmela, she and of course she was born to play that role. She was brilliant. But our casting directors brought in, Mike Rispoli, Imperioli, just these wonderful, wonderful
Victor
actors,
Argo.
Victor Argo. So wonderful people that we continue to have a relationship with. Yeah.
Oh, that's great. What was the actual experience of filming and producing that film?
For me, I was really pregnant. Like really, really pregnant. So I just remember a lot of body weight, like having to carry extra body weight. And my daughter Martine actually, Jacob Burns is showing her
We
documentary
are.
too, which is wonderful. I'm so excited by that. She took all this new footage that we found when we discovered the film, and I told her, I said, "You're the perfect person to do this because it's her story too. Like she was there."
Yeah, and looking back for the documentary and looking for, still photos, I mean, it's pretty much go back to Martina's baby album, because that was post-production, and release of the movie.
Right. There's Martina in the sound mix. There's Martina in the pickup shots. There's.
Oh.
Yeah.
And what was that like to see Martina's finished documentary about the making of Household Saints?
was very emotional for me. I felt like I don't think I could have handled, you know, because there's always a question, oh, would you like to do it? I couldn't have handled that material. There was so much that I had attached to it. And for her to come in and bring in her perspective was really beautiful to see. And I learned things.
Yeah, it was interesting too, because while I produced it, I didn't really get that involved. I handed over the footage because we had tons of actual interview footage from the original electronic press kit back in 1992 with Jonathan Demme, the exec producer, and Tracy Ullman and Nancy and I and all that. But what impressed, I think, us both in that first cut was the way she was able to cut together, each of us, like we were talking, our present selves were talking to ourselves 30 years ago. So it was very interesting, the way they pulled the material together, and the way she connected her personal connection to the film. So.
Absolutely. I agree. It's a really lovely tribute and time capsule, really, of that film and that experience. So after you made your third feature, both busy filmmakers, you go on to the next project and the next project. At what point did you realize that Household Saints went missing?
Well,
We both went, We saw it disappearing.
it never made the transition from DVD to DVD. There's never anyone to ask why. I mean, at that point, big corporations control it, and even if you sought out someone, you probably wouldn't get an answer or return email.
And let's remember, like we are a part of a very big group of movies that did not make that transition. And you always assume that it's, you know, the value that's given to the movie, like, is it worth it to take this money and that it costs to go to the next, migrate to the new technology? So you just assume, well, you know, the answer for that company was no, this movie did not have that value. And then you'd watch it kind of disappear on a lot of levels. Like it used to be on television and, you know, every Easter, and then that kind of stopped. Then you kind of, you know, you under that, that's all understandable. But it is sad when you watch the physical media disappearing because the VHS copies are a finite number. And I would look at it every once in a while. It was like somebody would send me, look, it's on eBay for $300, or it's on eBay for 99 cents. So it's like,
Yeah.
it's just crazy.
So the real, inflection point was when Ira Deutschman reached out to me because he wanted to screen it for a class at Columbia University. Now, Ira had been the executive at Fine Line Features, who greenlit the movie, and when he wanted to screen it, obviously, since it
The
never
choice was either
transitioned,
VHS or 35mm print.
So he asked if we had a 35 print, and proudly said, yes, we do. Actually, it's with the UCLA Film Archives. There are actually two prints there, both of which we had gotten through. One was mistakenly sent back to our house from a film festival. Instead of going back to the distributor, they sent it to us. Another one was left in a theater, and the theater reached out to us. And so, we grabbed them up and we sent them off without ever being able to check them. I mean, that's the difficult part with 35. I mean, it's not like I can just, open up the cans and start, unspooling
Unspooling.
reels. I didn't check them. I just forwarded them on to UCLA. And it turned out when I contacted UCLA, it turned out that both of those prints had several reels that were damaged to the point where they couldn't be screened. And neither UCLA nor we knew that at the time. So the next step then was to reach to contact the Who I thought was the distributor was Warner Brothers. Warner Brothers had purchased New Line, which owned Fine Line, which made the movie. And when I reached out to them at the vault, they said, well, we don't own the rights, so we don't have the materials. Okay, who's got the materials? Oh, I don't know, probably destroyed.
And what
Okay.
that was the moment when we realized that when we had It's truly, we had a missing movie. There was nothing.
Yeah. And so at that moment, all we had was a VHS copy.
Wow.
And so what the next step was, I went back to Ira and Ira said, well, let me see if I can get a, you know, let me see if I can look into this. And he went back to Warner Brothers to, I believe at the time it was Toby Emmerich was the head of the studio. And about a week later, I got a phone call from the head of the vault. And he said, I understand you're asking about Household Saints. I said, yes. He said, I got 120 boxes. Where do you want them? So fortunately, Nancy's, there's a lot of fortunately's in this story. And the timeline is also fortunate because this was only a 6-year period. It's only 6 years ago that this all began. And so at that moment, Nancy's archives are with the University of Michigan. So I called Michigan and I said, can you take this stuff for me? Because I have no idea what it is. You know, I need someplace for it to go because it can't come to my Manhattan apartment. And they took it. And in there, we did find prints. We found those interviews. We found out there was a box of Beta SP tapes, which, you know, we realized were all these old interviews. We found all the materials necessary to restore the film. An inner positive, inner negative, all of that stuff.
And that's where Milestone came in, Dennis Doris and Amy Heller.
Yeah. Of course, at that point, this was only 3 years into this saga. So at that point, I had to then figure out, well, who does have the rights? Mm-hmm. And able to, again, through good fortune, there was an equity investor, because these deals in the 90s, part of what makes a movie go missing is sometimes it's hard to find the trail of the rights. A lot of companies, a lot of big companies actually don't know they have the rights to these films. In this case, it took four companies and three different banks to put together the financing for Household Saints, because of, it was, as you can see, a pretty unique film. And the equity investor, part of their deal was to get the copyright. Now, that equity investor only invested in two films. One of them was Household Saints, and the other was a John Sayles movie called The Secret of Ronin Ish. Oh. And many years earlier, John's producer, Maggie Renzi, had negotiated a buyback of that film. So they bought that film back. And so she had the contact information that she had a place for me to start on the trail. And
that's another fortunately situation.
Another good fortune. And then finally, you know, when I did reach out, what I found was that the investor had passed away, the companies were dissolved, and I got an estate lawyer who basically said to me, what? There's another one? And so back and forth over another year or so, I was able to, you know, negotiate that buyback. And then we had the as Nancy said, Milestone came on board, found the money to do the restoration, and and that's where we are.
So I'm really excited to talk with both you and Amy and Dennis when we all get together for our screening of Household Saints. But I also wanted to ask you, you're still working with Amy and Dennis as part of Missing Movies.
Yes.
So you're not just, you know, you didn't just solve your mystery, you're also helping other filmmakers solve their mysteries. Could you tell us a little bit about that work?
I think just going through this experience was so incredibly painful. And, you know, you put everything into, we put everything into these films, all of us, and we're not the only ones, so many filmmakers. And then when things like this happen, again, we had a couple of, luckily this happened, and luckily we knew that person, and luckily, and for everybody, the story's going to be different, and some of them are going to have not as many luckilies. So it was just a question of like, how many more people are in this boat with us? And we guessed that it was a lot. And what we're been kind of astounded to find is that there is even more than we imagined. It's a big problem.
How big, roughly?
Oh,
Well, let's see. How
I mean,
how do you
I mean, I don't know how to quantify it really, because if you want to talk about one of the things that came out of this was Nancy decided, you know, she said, if this is happening to me, it's happening to other people. She went to the DGA, Directors Guild of America, and to Mary Harron, who runs the Independent Directors Committee on the East Coast, and said, you know, maybe we should do something about the, you know, a panel or a webinar or something. And Mary Harron, I shot Andy Warhol. She said,
that's
the same thing.
Yep.
Let's reach out. Let's see if Mira Nair wants to be on the panel. Well, Mississippi Masala, she had just gone through the exact same thing where she thought there was only one 35 millimeter print in the world of that movie. So to give you an idea, what happened was they did the webinar. And a group of us, including Dennis and Amy, entertainment lawyer Susan Bodine, Ira Deutschman, Mary Harron, we decided to keep talking about this. And out of that came this not-for-profit called Missing Movies. As far as scope, we did one research project going back to Sundance from its inception through, I think, about 2007 or 2008, all of the films that were selected. So these were curated films. Now, not all of them got distribution, but of all the selections in that period, at the moment, there are over 1,400 films that you can't see right now.
Missing.
I mean, we have others. I mean,
I'm so happy to celebrate that this movie is available now for people, but that's just the beginning because I have other films.
In terms of numbers, I saw an article recently about if you're a cinephile, you want to subscribe to Amazon Prime because they have 12,000 titles. Well, anybody in New York City knew there was a video store called Kim's Video that had 60,000 titles. The greatest video store of all time was Netflix with DVDs when they had 110,000 titles. There are a fraction of the films available on streaming that there were when physical media existed. And, you know,
I think that's what we want the public to be aware of. If you love films, if you are a film fan, you already know this, but let's be clear that this is a huge problem that's growing, that these movies are becoming unavailable for us. Some of us that love films, we watch movies for our own edification, because we love them, because it reminds us of a time, a certain period of our life, because we want to learn something new. We'll rewatch a movie and see something different every time. There's an incredible enjoyment of this culture. We want to pass it down to our kids. We want our kids to see the movie. I'm a teacher also. A student comes to me with a screenplay and I'm like, oh my gosh, so this subject matter you're taking on, you should watch this, 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 and this movie. You wanted to shoot in this style, watch this movie. They're not available. I want to do research for my own films as a filmmaker. They're not available. So our own inspiration for now, for the future of film, we can't go back and look at the work that can inspire us to move forward. We're talking about, there are teachers that teach cinema study courses. Cinema studies is all about the history of film. There are films they cannot access for their students. So they're just talking about these films without having seen them. It's a problem.
Yeah,
it's big.
It's actually a very big problem. And two missions for our Missing Movies. One is to help filmmakers track down the rights, because the rights can be, you know, as complicated or more complicated than materials. So we're setting up a pro bono legal referral service in conjunction with Volunteer Lawyers for the Arts in New York. So that's a program that's actively, we're gonna start to hopefully put that into action by the end of the year. And the other thing which we have on our website is a preservation guide for filmmakers. Essentially, you really have to take this into your own hands, because, you know, we always ask the question, you know, will your film be available in 20 years? And having it on one hard drive in your closet is not really enough. Digital has made it easier, as long as you take the right steps, as long as you don't rely on you know, that lacy hard drive, where you know the connections have all changed, or you don't have the plugs, and you don't need, you know. So on the website we have this thing called the preservation guide for
And
filmmakers.
this is a minimal so that if you don't, you know, you'll apply, you, some people might apply for grants and stuff to get these, their films restored. You may not get it. If you don't get it, here's what you can do. The minimal that you can do, and there's even, you know, at the most basic is just make digital copies of everything and store it in different places. That's like the bottom line is what you do. But I think, I mean, for me, that it's so important to know that movies that have been Oscar nominated, Oscar winning, are missing. Okay, so if they're missing, guess who goes first? All the marginal filmmakers. So you have gay films, black films, Latino films, Asian films, films by women. Why? We have a lot of women in our missing movies advisory group. Our movies go missing fast. And then what happens is, you know, you get people like 100 years down. I'm getting older, so I am thinking about the future. You know that 100 years down, they're going to look back and they're going to say, I don't think, you know, people of color made movies or women made movies. No, probably not, because we can't see them. So they don't exist. So it didn't happen. So it's so important. The preservation of these films is so important also to show diversity.
Including Household Saints, you've also had a few other success stories in just your few years that Missing Movies has been going. Could you tell us a bit more about those films?
Well, I'm just trying to think. We don't really claim, ownership on these things. We're here to help the filmmakers. I mean, there have been
The
a few films.
loudspeaker amplifying the problem. We cannot, we actually do not have the resources to save movies. What we can do is say this movie's missing. Anybody out there who can join together with the people who made it and, you know, save it.
I mean, we're working on a number of things right now that we were hoping had, we had a similar situation with rights issues that have not quite come to pass. I'm happy to say I believe the hurdles have been cleared for a shot at Andy Warhol. That's been ongoing. Dennis and Amy, their work on this is tireless. I mean, we just went to the premiere of Annihilation of Fish, a Charles Burnett film that was never released. And Dennis has been working on that. I believe he said it was 19 years.
So this is like detective work. This is like, it is so incredibly like the passion that Dennis and Amy have for this is amazing. I feel like we're like cheerleaders more than anything, and maybe connectors. We hope to connect people who are have all these are because there's so many aspects to this. There's archivists, there's, you know, there's research, there's so and legal. So to hoping to connect all these people. But the when talk about Annihilation of Fish, like we sat in the audience, a good sized big audience, they loved that movie. That movie never had a chance. It never came out. But now it's out and people can enjoy it. And we could see Charles Burnett like thrilled. He was like watching it with the audience. And it was so, as a filmmaker, it must be incredibly amazing, you know, to have these opportunities. So yeah. And we benefit as film fans.
Well, and speaking as two filmmakers whose film has returned to audience, what has that experience been like to have screening after screening of a new generation seeing your film for the first time?
It's been pretty, well, the whole thing's been such a surprise for us because I was so thrilled that it was going to be restored. And I thought, restored, put it on DVD finally. Yay. Great. What more can you ask for? And the answer was, I didn't even know to ask for. It's in theaters. It's being released and it's playing in over
It's
20.
played in over 25 venues here, but it also what it's done is it's by coincidence, all three films, the first three films, are out on DVD actually next week, and Blu-ray, and have been restored. So the Household Saints has been dragging the others along. So the Cinémathèque Française screened all three. The American Cinematheque screened it. The Sydney International Film Festival in Australia is screening it next month. So it's been quite amazing. And the most fun for me, because all I ever was interested in is having people see the movies,
Accessibility,
you know,
yeah.
accessibility. The most exciting thing is to have young audiences who just really respond to the movie. I mean, there's always somebody in the audience with a VHS cassette that wants Nancy to autograph.
Right. That's the older fans, which we love those
guys.
We
love that.
And then there's the new people that come up and go like, wow, this is like really different. And they're, you know, relating to different characters and bringing them up of Household Saints. And it's just really fun because that's what you do it for.
Yeah. So it's been amazing. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, Nancy, Rich, thank you so much for your time. And we look forward to seeing you in May for Restored and Rediscovered.
Oh, my gosh. Excellent. Jacob Burns Film Center. You guys are the best. We've been with you guys from the get-go. And we're thrilled to be a part of it, of your new series. And I'm going to be going to all your other movies, too.
So. Oh, good. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks so much.